6 o'clock.
We're ready whenever you are.
Okay. Welcome, everybody. I would like to convene this special meeting of the Board of Directors of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District at 6 o'clock. Holly, will you call the roll?
President Mayhood.
Here.
Director Falls.
Here.
Director Henry.
Here.
Director Tu.
Present.
Thank you.
Okay. Are there any additions or deletions to the agenda?
Yes, Chair Mayhood, I would like to remove, delete item 3E, unfinished business, respectful workplace policy from the agenda.
Okay. And you want to explain why?
Staff ran out of time to thoroughly put it together.
Okay.
To get it to the board.
Okay. I'm inclined to agree to delete this, but if there are any comments from the board first, I'll be happy to hear them. Hearing none?
I just had no objection.
Oh, okay. With no objections heard, I'll go ahead and approve that deletion of item 3E. And now we come to the portion of the agenda that's reserved for oral communications from members of the public on subjects that lie within the purview of the district but are not on the agenda tonight. Because we have a long meeting tonight, I would like to limit your presentations, if you have any, to 3 minutes. And when you do speak, please give your name and the town that you reside in. Are there any comments in this section of the... Okay. Then can we have District Council talk about the chat function, please?
Okay, thank you, Chair Mayhood. I just want to let everybody know, please refrain from using the chat function during the meeting. Not all of the panelists, in particular the board members, monitors chat throughout the meeting. So if you, in order to make sure that you're participating in the meeting and that the board members all hear you, it's important to participate in oral communication rather than communicating via chat. Should you type any message into chat, that will be a public record subject to the Public Records Act. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to rise on a point of privilege right now before we get into the main part of the meeting. And it's basically because at the last meeting, we got off to a little bit of a rocky start. I lost control of the meeting at times, and I also lost control of my temper, for which I apologize. And given that, I thought I would take a few minutes at the beginning of this meeting to state my intentions and goals in chairing the board's meetings. And these largely arise actually from the first conversation that I had when I met Tina after we were both elected. We both immediately agreed that board meetings are too long, with the result that it's a serious imposition on staff, many of whom start work at 6 or 7 a.m. We were also concerned that these long meetings are a barrier to public participation. We really can't expect public to hang in there for 3 and 4 hour long meetings, especially those who have families or that work. So we agreed that what we would try to aim for as an ideal are meetings that last no longer than 2.5 hours. We also agreed that it'd be better if all board members weighed in on issues rather than discussions being dominated by just a couple of board members, as we commonly observed when we attended meetings last year. So to that end, I intend to do my best to run meetings efficiently so that we adjourn no later tonight than 8:30, and regular meetings that start at 6:30 at 9 p.m. And to make sure that all members of the board have an equal chance to influence the course of decision, the course of the discussions that we have with agenda items, rather than call on the person who raises their hand first, each time we go to the board for comment, I'll invite the next director on an alphabetical list to start the discussion. Similarly, I'll do that with the public, calling on them in such a way that different people can lead off the discussion. So the way this will go will be back to our sort of normal way, in contrast to the first meeting, where the item is presented by the staff. I'll then invite each member of the board to make a comment. They don't always have to, but they'll be invited to, before the floor is opened up to members of public. And once we've heard from the public with their comments, I will return to the board and invite each member to make a comment before we consider entertaining a motion. And once a motion is made and seconded, each member will be allowed to comment at that time. So with that, I'd like to start on our first piece of unfinished business, 3A, which is the vacancy in elective office of the Board of Directors. Rick, did you want to start that off?
Yeah, I'll just, you know, introduce I'll introduce District Council Nichols to present this item, open it to the board.
Okay.
Well, this item, of course, has been before the board of several times now over the past few months, so I won't go into any great amount of detail. In short, the board determined that a vacancy exists as of November 5th, 2020. That was the board seat held by former President Steve Swan, whose term was scheduled to end at the end of 2022. The board ultimately, after a few meetings, determined to fill the vacancy by appointment. The board has until January 4th to make an appointment, which may, of course, be done at this meeting here tonight. And I believe the district secretary is prepared to swear in any appointee that may be chosen by the board at this evening's meeting.
I am.
Thank you.
Okay. We received five applications, and I just want to make sure that everybody, those five people are here. I saw Jamie Ackerman is here. Mark Dolson, are you there? Mark? Might be a good idea for you to unmute, Mark.
Now I'm unmuted and here.
Okay, all right, thank you. Alina Lang?
Present.
Thank you. Jamie Newton? Jamie, I know you're there. Want to unmute?
I didn't know if I had control of my mute. They're present.
Yeah, you do, right. Okay. And Mark Smalley?
Here.
Okay, great. All right, well, let me just explain to everybody how this is going to go. And the five applicants have all been informed of this in an email beforehand, so I'm not springing anything on them here. Each one of them will be given 4 minutes to introduce themselves, and that will be followed by me asking a set of standard questions to each of them, four questions, and then each member of the board will be offered the opportunity to ask a question of a candidate if they'd like, and we'll do that for each person sequentially. After we've interviewed all five, we'll go to the board for a single comment for each board member, then out to the public for their comment. And then we'll come back to the board for discussion of the candidates at least one round before we invite a motion. So with that, I would like to get started on this with Jamie Ackerman. She's there. And I just want to state up front that in posing the questions, we're looking for the person that's best qualified to join the board at this juncture that we find ourselves at. You may not be able to answer every question I ask, that's okay, but do use the opportunity the questions afford to provide the strongest case you can for why we should choose you. So Jamie, if you're ready, the first question is, please provide a specific example from your own experience working on a board or a committee or in some context in which you helped a group of people with diverse perspectives and opinions collectively reach agreement on a contentious issue. What did you do to influence the group, and what was the outcome?
Sure. First, I'll be happy to answer that question, but if I could ask a quick question about procedure before.
Oh, I'm sorry, you've got 4 minutes. I jumped in. I'm sorry. Thank you. Go ahead. Thank you for calling me on that.
One second, Board President. This is James, Director of Operations. Am I timing this?
Yes, that would be great.
Okay, just wanted to be sure.
Okay, good evening, board members, Water District staff, and neighbors. First, I just want to offer my thanks to the Water District staff and first responders who fought the fire and restored our community. As a water service industry professional, I understand the dedication it takes to respond at a moment's notice when a community's water resources are in crisis. I was with San Jose Water when we had an E. coli outbreak, when construction broke major water mains, and through many more mundane water emergencies. My job as Director of Communications was to work with the local neighborhoods and businesses to provide messaging and outreach to local elected officials and customers, and to really win the hearts and minds of the community so that they understood what we were doing with their rates and fees to invest in their water system. I've never faced a crisis in my professional life like the one we all faced down as a community this summer during the fires. My home is just 1,000 feet from where the fire stopped at the top of Valley View Road in Ben Lomond. And because of that, I've never been more grateful to be a resident of the San Lorenzo Valley, and specifically the Lomond Terrace Association in Ben Lomond. And if any of my neighbors are on the line tonight, thank you so much for all of your support. That is part of my motivation to find ways to be more involved locally. My work has largely focused on public infrastructure issues and good governance. And as a graduate of Leadership San Jose and a member of Women in Transportation, I was focused on building a more accessible and equitable world through which to travel. I believed then, and I continue to believe today, that transportation is key to a healthy community. But through that advocacy work, I came to see the interconnectedness of our housing, water, electrical, and environmental solutions, and how our water infrastructure and services were suffering in many of the same ways the rest of our country's infrastructure is suffering. The American Society of Civil Engineers gives our nation's water infrastructure a D+. But solving the problem is as much a generational challenge as the original construction of our systems were between the early 1900s and the end of the baby boom. The most important work this board will do is to create a legacy of improvements, but also a commitment to continually improve the San Lorenzo Valley watershed and water services. And to do that, we need to build an ongoing dialogue with the greater San Lorenzo Valley, our regional, state, and federal representatives, and more importantly, with each other. I believe my background in government relations, community outreach and organizing, and communications will be an asset to this board and to the district. In 2018, the Santa Cruz County Grand Jury issued a report that focused on two primary concerns: a lack of outreach and communication with the community, and poor coordination with and guidance to the Lompico Assessment District Oversight Committee. While I appreciate the unprecedented nature of some of the challenges the district has faced in the past year, we have more work to do in curing the concerns leveled by that grand jury report. My background as a water industry communications expert and my previous experience as staff liaison to various Brown Act governed committees gives me the skills and tools to help the district and this board meet its goals. In short, this board has incredibly important decisions that will need to be made quickly. We need to recover federal emergency management funds. I have relationships with Anna Eshoo's office and with most of our state and regional legislators. We need to continue to move capital improvement projects forward, like the Country Club Lane Tank Installation Project. I was pivotal in obtaining federal funding for Caltrain electrification in the Bay Area, not to mention untold other capital infrastructure improvements. We have the perennial work of restoring and maintaining the health of our watershed, and I too understand that from my work with San Jose Water, which manages thousands of acres of watershed in the Santa Cruz Mountains. Your job tonight is difficult. You have to try to reflect the voice of the community in your decision, because San Lorenzo Valley residents don't get a chance to weigh in on this appointment until 2022. I submit that last month, when President Mahood supported the effort to seek an appointee, she said that the board could benefit from a fresh new perspective. And clearly the grand jury has weighed in to see that the board could do more to connect with our community too. I hope that the more than a dozen letters of support and comments you've received about my appointment, combined with my strong background as a candidate, will offer the fresh perspective President Mahood referred to. Reaching beyond your inner circle sends the right message to the broader San Lorenzo Valley community about your desire to bring their voice into this process. And with that, I'm open for your questions.
Okay. So let me state the first one again. Thank you. Please provide a specific example from your own experience working on a board, a committee, or in some other context in which you helped a group of people with diverse perspectives and opinions collectively reach agreement on a contentious issue. What did you do to influence the group, and what was the outcome?
Most recently, I worked with the Santa Cruz County Regional Transportation Commission as staff via my role with as the Director of Communications for Santa Cruz Metro. We were working on the bus improvement auxiliary lanes project. So the goal of that project is to add some lane space along Highway 1 so that buses can actually have places to pull on and pull off more quickly, improving the flow of traffic, giving us a rapid transportation corridor. But it has some impacts that are controversial for the community, and obviously it could impact the flow of traffic along that corridor, things that are already challenging. So we worked carefully with the community and with county supervisors, members of the Regional Transportation Commission, to try and cure those concerns and ensure that the project really reflected the needs of the community. And in fact, it's been funded and it's already moving into construction.
Yeah, thank you. My second question is, please describe what you think is at stake in the district's participation in the Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency.
Well, management of our groundwater resources is, you know, pretty critical in this valley in particular, but I'm sure that throughout Santa Cruz County that's an issue. When I was with San Jose Water, we relied heavily on groundwater for water distribution, and it has different and unique challenges than using surface water does in terms of treatment and in terms of quality issues with the customers. So I think that having a voice in that board and continuing to ensure that our concerns in the valley are heard is what the goal of good governance is in participating with this board.
Could you please describe your engagement with the workings of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District up until this point in time?
I'm a customer. I've been following the things that you're doing, but I haven't been heavily engaged. That's largely because I've also been raising kids and working over the hill for the vast majority of my career until just the last year or so when I moved into my role with Santa Cruz Metro and then when I went into consulting. So I now am here and have much more time to commit to a project like this. And that's really the issue, is you need to make sure whomever you appoint really has the time for long board meetings and responding to and engaging with constituents. I get that challenge because as a public agency staffer for the last 20 years, I've been staffed to these meetings. So I really appreciate what you were saying, President Mahood, about trying to be respectful of the water district staff when you're managing these meetings as well.
Well, that sort of segues into my last question, which is, as you just said, being a member of the board is a major commitment of time, especially, you know, the financial problems of COVID and post-CZU fire issues. So board members can expect to spend on the order of 10 to 20 hours, sometimes more per week, attending board and committee meetings, reading agenda background material, and preparing to be an active participant. Can you please describe how you plan to integrate this commitment and work with any other obligations that you have?
Sure. Actually, this kind of comes at a really perfect time for me personally, because as luck would have it, at the beginning of 2020, I made the decision to go out on my own as a communications consultant and writer. And my last day at work, I had turned in my resignation, was March 13th, as luck would have it. And the very next day we went into shelter in place. So all of the big plans that I had for this time I was taking to move into consulting, I was going to volunteer at the local library, I was going to get involved with the community in ways that I had never had time to do, really were upended. And then the fires, of course, changed the course of, I think, all of our sort of focuses and priorities. So this opportunity is what I had hoped to do with this time and what how I intend to spend a lot of my focus, not just with this board, but in trying to find other ways to involve myself in this community. To that end, I've joined the Valley Women's Club. I've joined their both their women's issues and environmental issues. I'll be starting a column with the San Lorenzo Valley Post shortly on my thoughts around water and environmental issues. And I'm writing for a couple of other local publications as well, including Santa Cruz Waves.
Thank you. We now can go to the board and each board member, if they'd like, can ask a question, and I'll begin with Director Fultz.
Yes, thank you very much, Jamie, for that background and the answers to that. I think from my perspective, we're looking at a very robust set of applicants. So I have one question, which is, what do you view as the most critical item for the San Lorenzo Valley Water District to focus on in the next year or two?
Well, I mean, you know, the best laid plans are are never able to be, you know, followed to a T, right? I would say that because of the fires, the recovery of federal emergency management funds, the recovery and restoration of the watershed, and the continued hardening and strengthening of our facilities is probably going to be amongst our top priorities. But to that end, we're going to have to look at all of the financial considerations behind that. As a certified rate adjuster with the National Association of Regulatory Utility Commissioners, I have a lot of background in really understanding a public utility agency's financials.
Great, thank you.
Thank you. Director Henry?
Thank you. Jamie, very impressive. I do have a question. I noticed that you worked for San Jose Waterworks, a company that is listed on the New York Stock Exchange, and also and it is the PUC is the one who oversees San Jose Water Works, and also that you were involved in a merger between Connecticut Water and San Jose Water. And so my question is, are you in favor of prioritizing water districts, or do you think it doesn't matter whether it's prioritized or a water district or a mutual?
So I think you mean privatized. Yes. I'm not sure what you mean by prioritized.
A private company.
Yes. She meant privatization.
Ah, got it. So I left San Jose Water in the midst of their merger with Connecticut Water because I don't agree with private utility operated, private investor-owned utilities. I spent 2 years there, and it was a real lesson. I got to learn all aspects of watershed maintenance, operations, administration, and rate setting, but I didn't like the model. I am a public agency employee, and if you look at the rest of my career, and I'm sure you looked at my resume, Director Henry, you would see that from 2000 to 2018, I worked for public agencies like the San Mateo County Transit District, the Santa Clara Valley Transportation Agency, and Santa Cruz Metro. And for 2 years, I worked at San Jose Water. It was a really great opportunity and a learning experience, but it wasn't a model that I thought was the right model for water distribution.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Director Toe.
President, did you have a question first, or are you going after me?
No, go ahead.
I just want to say I'm really impressed with your resume and all of the references you sent. I actually don't have a question at this time.
That's fine. We don't have to have questions. All right. Well, then, thank you very much, Jamie. I appreciate your answers. And So next we have Mark Dolson. And you have 4 minutes to introduce yourself. And James, you want to kind of give an indication somewhere around 3.5 minutes so people know how much time they have?
I'll do.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Well, you know, I think maybe the most important thing for me to say is that about this position itself, I know there's been a lot of discussion in recent weeks about this opening. And, you know, I've seen it treated as a primarily political issue. I don't see it that way. I see the board as a team, and I see this appointment as a critical opportunity to strengthen that team. So the way I look at it, if I were already on the board, what would I be doing at this point? I'd be looking, and this gives you some sense of how I operate, I think. I would be looking to add someone who's hardworking, you know, someone highly collaborative, you know, someone with a solid understanding of the challenges facing the district, someone with strong analytical skills, excellent communication skills, all those things I think, you know, seem pretty obvious. But also, I'd really be looking for someone who can help to make all four other board members more effective. That's really what interests me most. I'm applying for this position because I think I fit this description, both based on my career experience in which team building has been really a top priority for me, and also just because I've been so immersed in over the past year in the board's activities. I've devoted, you know, many hours each month to not just attending the meetings, but publishing, you know, detailed summaries of each board meeting, you know, to understanding the district's issues, the board dynamics, writing lengthy articles about the issues confronting the district. So, you know, I've come to believe that the most critical long-term issue that the district does need to contend with is its precarious financial status. I mean, this is a predicament that's a consequence of years of underinvestment in physical infrastructure, but also escalating costs, and now due to the fire, depletion of cash reserves. It's something we need to address, but also we need to be attentive to other issues as well. You know, I'm certainly concerned about optimizing the overall effectiveness of staff, managing evolving threats to the watershed, and partnering effectively with other agencies and with our community. So I regard all of those things as the board's mission. But to accomplish this, you know, I think we need a board that's working together at peak efficiency. And that doesn't mean a board that always agrees. It means a board that is learning from disagreements so that they're productive and they're enabling us to jointly build on what we've learned. Just to cite an example here, I've had many, many hours of discussion with Director Foltz, and we've disagreed on a number of points, but I've always come away from those discussions feeling that my overall understanding has been improved, and also that there are constructive next steps that we could take together. So if I were to end up on the board, you know, I would look forward to pursuing those kinds of really mutual learning opportunities with all the directors, because for me, that's really what the draw is. I think the board can be more effective than it has been to date. It's all about building the strongest possible team. There's a lot of important work to do. And I guess what I would say to the board members, if you share this agenda, I hope you will strongly consider me for this position. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, so let me go to the first question. Please provide a specific example from your own experience working on a board, a committee, or some other context in which you helped a group of people with diverse perspectives and opinions collectively reach agreement on a contentious issue. What did you do to influence the group, and what was the outcome?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. And of course, as soon as you posed it, I started thinking back that the experience, you know, for me that was most formative and had the most profound influence on me actually came a number of years ago when I first found myself in position of responsibility. This was working for the Creative Advanced Technology Center in Scotts Valley. We had about 100 members of staff, and we had a team of four directors who were jointly responsible for that organization. We were part of a larger company, a company based in Singapore, but that gave us a lot of autonomy in how we operated. And there was a lot of learning as we went. There was a lot of helpful coaching as well. But you know, the fundamental issue, and it repeated again and again, was that, you know, amongst the directors, we had very different personalities and areas of expertise. And so we needed to learn how to have productive discussions amongst ourselves. At the same time, we needed to learn how to have effective engagement with all of the other people on the staff, you know, many of whom were engineers, also very opinionated. And so I learned an awful lot in that time about how to really understand what people's concerns are and how to effectively address them, how to build trust with people. And then probably the biggest challenge for us was that we still needed to have those same kinds of successful interactions with the senior management in Singapore, who had a very different perspective and even a different cultural approach to things. So even though I didn't give you a very specific example there, it was a sustained experience over a number of years and ultimately a very satisfying one, but that's really what drew me into this role of focusing on team building.
Okay, thank you. My second question is, please describe what you think is at stake in the district's participation in the Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency.
Yes, that's a question that I don't feel I have a lot of expertise in that area. You know, I have sat in on some of the Groundwater Association meetings, and the fundamental situation there, where there are disparate communities that are coming together to try and have a common plan, Scotts Valley, San Lorenzo Valley, and Santa Cruz, you know, inherently sets up differences in, you know, in people's interests and priorities. And Scotts Valley has a very different population than we do and has made different demands on their groundwater, you know, than the San Lorenzo Valley has. So to be completely honest, I don't know specifically what the most pressing current issue is with that agency, but I believe it's very important for the San Lorenzo Valley to be effectively represented in that, both in the sense of reaching consensus in the ongoing planning, joint planning, and also making sure that planning doesn't adversely affect the valley.
Okay. Please describe your engagement with the workings of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District up until this point in time.
Sure. If you go back, you know, maybe 14 months or so, I had very little awareness of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District. So for me, it's been a really intensive learning experience over the past year and a few months. The form of that has come from, as I said, participating primarily as a spectator in all of the meetings, but doing a lot of work to try to understand and summarize what's been going on and try and move from that to understanding what the underlying issues are, trying to research those. So, you know, I've had to do a fair amount of investigation, and I've had to do a fair amount of learning right from the start. The thing that interested me most was, what is it that all of these directors know that I don't yet know? And that's why I started reaching out to directors like Director Foltz, Director Swan, to try and accelerate my own learning process. I feel like I've lived very closely with the Water District since, you know, it's essentially November of last year, but obviously not as closely as the people on the board.
Okay. And the final question is, being a member of the board is a major commitment of time and energy, especially in this post-CZU and COVID-plagued interval. Board members can be expected to spend 10 to 20 hours per week, sometimes more, in attending board and committee meetings, reading agenda background materials, and preparing to be an active participant in meetings. Please describe how you plan to integrate this commitment and work with any other obligations you have.
happily at this time, I don't have any conflicting obligations, and this is precisely the kind of engagement that I very much enjoy and I'm naturally drawn to. So from my perspective, I would expect to ramp up the work that I've been doing as a citizen. If I were actually on the board member, I would clearly have additional responsibilities, but I don't anticipate any difficulty in handling those.
Okay, thank you. Now we'll see if there's any questions from the board. Director Henry?
Sure, thank you. Mark Dolson, thank you for your remarks. I don't know if you're aware that I was on the Lompico Water District Board for almost 8 years. It was short by 6 months because we managed to merge with SLV. I also attended Santa Margarita Basin meetings while I was on that board. And I can agree with you that having a board that works well together is wonderful. And I can remember being on the Lompico board, oh my gosh, it could get pretty difficult sometimes. And so I'm really in favor of a board that works well together. But of course we are going to have disagreements, and it's kind of how we handle those disagreements. And I can be a little bit of a hothead myself, so I sometimes am not very good about handling those disagreements, but I try. So I appreciate your willingness to apply for the board, and I also saw that you applied for the admin committee. Thank you.
Okay. Director To?
I also appreciate Mark's qualifications, but I do not have questions at this time. Okay.
Director Fultz?
Thank you, Mark. I don't have any questions at this time. We have talked extensively.
Okay.
Fair enough.
All right. Then we'll go on to our next candidate, Alina Lang. Can you tell me how to pronounce your name correctly?
Alina.
Alina, okay. All right, Alina, go ahead. You have 4 minutes to introduce yourself.
All right, well, my name's Lena Lang, and I'm a fisheries biologist. And I was asked to come to California to apply my expertise in passive integrated transponder technology to help better understand how drought conditions affect salmonid migration. And having the ability to monitor fish migration and behavior is crucial to understanding the impacts of extreme climate change conditions, water operations, and developing management strategies to minimize threats. And I've been a public servant my entire career, whether it be representing federal or state government, collecting critical data, or participating in non-proprietary research to create new open source technological advancements. I have experience with the National Marine Fisheries Service permitting large waterway infrastructure, whereas the project manager in the field overseeing the installation. For this project, I was also tasked with allocating the budget on a fixed firm contract to make sure our research goals are met. I performed many habitat surveys for National Marine Fisheries Service, Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife, and Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife. I fostered relationships with NGOs, private landowners, as well as local and federal agencies to allow site access and to build partnerships among agencies. I saw the impact firsthand of the previous fire and what it had on the water quality and how it affected the salmonid rearing at the Scott Creek Hatchery. I've been involved in many things in our area, including installing monitoring equipment on the Felton Bladder Dam and conducting topographic land surveys for the Carmel Dam Removal Geomorphological Study. Besides my scientific expertise, I deeply care about the affordability of clean drinking water and addressing the equity of water in an era of rising costs. It's extremely important that we design more effective water rate and fee assistance programs for low-income houses that are able that are unable to pay their bill. You know, one way of achieving this is, I know you guys have that the low income rate assistance program that's currently in the trial phase and making sure that we expand that. I'd also like to expand the communication between the board and our customers, especially as we navigate through this post-fire period. You know, there are going to be many opportunities moving forward post-fire for impactful change that will last for generations. This director seat should go to a scientist that knows how to best update our water infrastructure so we don't find ourselves repeating the same mistakes. My combination of watershed experience, public relations, public budget allocation, and the use of innovative technology makes me a good fit for this board seat. In the last election, the public overwhelmingly said with their votes they want scientists on their board and their wishes should be honored. When this position's 2 years term is up, I feel confident that I know how to run a successful campaign through my volunteer efforts, setting up phone banks and events for political candidates. On a personal note, I'm an avid mushroom picker. I enjoy hiking and camping with my wonderful husband who works at the Santa Clara Valley Water District and my four-year-old son. The last research project I was a part of was published and I decided to be at home and take on the challenges of a fixer-upper that we bought here in Boulder Creek. I was actually originally looking to return to the workforce and then COVID hit and child care was an issue, so I decided to stay home longer. So this means that sitting on the board will be my sole focus and I can dedicate myself fully to this endeavor. I just really want to thank the board for the consideration and it'd be an honor to serve our community.
All right, thank you. Okay, my first question is, please provide a specific example from your own experience on a board, a committee, or in some other context in which you helped a group of people with diverse perspectives and opinions collectively reach agreement on a contentious issue. What did you do to influence the group and what was the outcome?
Yeah, well, I've been involved in a lot of the Central Valley acoustic tagging committees. And there's definitely a lot of diverse backgrounding from academia, research, to working with CDFW and even in water districts that all show up to these meetings and how to best use the technology to track salmonid migration. And our big role was to bring in passive integrative technology or PIT tags down into California, which hadn't seen this technology. Most people down here use acoustic technology. So we had a lot of pushback. A lot of people didn't want to, you know, kind of have something else in the mix. And we had to go in there and present and explain to them like how this PIT tag technology could close, our critical data gaps. And it would be really helpful to add this to our tool belt. And in the end, we got people on board and we ended up collaborating with several different agencies. We had some people that were already doing some acoustic tagging and they let us piggyback onto them and insert our PIT tags at the moment that they were doing the surgery. And we ended up having a really successful research project.
Okay, thank you. Please describe what you think is at stake in the district's participation in the Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency.
I'm not too familiar with this. I do know a lot about groundwater, and especially what's going around in the area in Central Valley. And, I understand that the recharge that we in this area only comes from rainfall and that the aquifers below are low. And I know a lot with the Santa Clara Valley Water District, when they do water releases to try to get fish to move up it, it just soaks right into the ground because the groundwater is so low. So I think we have a lot at stake here because the fact that we may not have surface water intake, for a while with contaminations and debris flows, and this might be our only chance at being able to provide water if something happens. So I think it's very important that we collaborate with these people, and especially for the fact that if everyone has a straw and we're not working together and we're all just sucking out water, like we're just going to further deplete it. So we definitely have to come to collaborate with everyone else on this issue so we're allocating the water appropriately.
Thank you. Please describe your engagement with the workings of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District up until this point in time.
Well, I I watched your meetings a lot, and I did apply to be on the environmental committee because I wanted to be more involved. And then this position opened up, so I thought I was vying this position, but you know, maybe in 2 years when I had served on the environmental committee, because you know there were no positions open at the time. So not as much as I would like, but I'm trying to change that by being more involved.
Okay. I think you sort of answered this already, but everybody gets a fair chance on this. So being a member of the board is a major commitment of time and energy, and board members can expect to spend 10 to 20 hours per week, sometimes more, in attending board and committee meetings, reading agenda background material, and preparing to be active participants in board deliberations. Please describe how you plan to integrate this commitment and work with any other obligations you have.
Yeah, well, we are wrapping up, I think, hopefully, our fixer-upper. So, and like I said, I was planning to go back to work, but with COVID and childhood care, that just wasn't something that was possible. So my schedule is open, and this is my project, and I have the time, and I'm willing to put it in.
Okay, thank you very much. Now we'll go to the board. Director Toh.
I just wanted to thank Alina for applying, and as a fellow environmental scientist / marine scientist / ecologist, I really appreciate your resume. It was very impressive. Thank you.
Okay. Director Fultz.
Yeah, thank you. And of course, Alina, as someone who lived in the Oregon coast for a long time, I was pleased to see that you spent time in Newport. So that's really great. Fairly close to my old stomping grounds. You had mentioned during your introduction to us that there were mistakes that had been made. And I was wondering if you could expand on that. Were those mistakes that we make in general as a society, or were there specific things you thought might be the case here locally?
I'm sorry, I don't quite know where I said mistakes.
Oh, maybe I misunderstood.
Oh, repeating the same, I guess I did say that. Well, I mean, just like when the fire came through, it wiped out our ability to serve any water at all, because a lot of the pipe was above ground, and, you know, re-putting back in HDPE pipes again and above ground, and the fire comes through again, we see ourselves back in that same problem again. And you know, maybe we look at it and nothing really is feasible except above ground HDPE pipes in some areas. But you know, we need to be, you know, looking at like do like, I think we talked about this previously, like are we putting some of that outside of the watershed so the entire system isn't getting impacted altogether? You know, is there areas where we can put it underground where it's safer, or using other materials? Like I know, like when you use steel, there goes into the process of having to continually recoat those pipes. But I think it's just really important that we don't see ourselves back in this same position if another fire rolls through. So
no, I think that's a great point. Thank you for clarifying that, and I understand.
Okay. Director Henry.
Hey, Alina. I noticed in reading your resume that you've spent a lot of time out in the field doing all kinds of interesting things, I would imagine. And I find myself wondering if that's what you would rather be doing than to be in a board meeting, if you're really going to be happy being on a board where you don't get to go out and work in the field, which I get would be really a great thing to do with all your expertise. You have so much expertise.
Yeah. Oh, I hear you. Honestly, I like being in the field, but not so much in California with all your guys' poison oak and ticks. So I would gladly sit on the board down here. You know, I've had so much fun being in the field, but I also really enjoy, you know, making real change and being able to be a part of our community. And I really don't see that as a problem. I got enough, you know, side projects at home to keep me entertained, or go hike on my own on a trail and not have to be stomping through the ticks and poison oak anymore. So I don't see that as a problem.
Drink goat's milk, that the goat's been eating poison oak.
Yeah.
It helps.
I've never gotten poison oak until I moved to California, and then I got it really, really bad. And I mean, I'm not even everywhere, so.
All right, thank you, Alina. All right. Next we have Jamie Newton. And Jamie, would you please go ahead and take 4 minutes to introduce yourself?
I don't know if I'm gonna take 4 minutes.
Well,
at first I want to say, I mean, I have been so impressed with all of these. I have questions for everybody. Everybody, what can I tell you about me? I don't remember where I found the application for this board of directors. And I picked it up because I'm concerned. I'm concerned that you're looking for somebody before it's time to look for somebody. I'm concerned about something so important as our water being in the hands of our community. I just felt compelled. I was absolutely compelled to get a hold of it and find out more about it. It's all gonna be an education for me, except for what experience I've had with it. I've been a customer I started out with Ampico. I've known Lois Henry's name for a long time. I got here in 2004, and Bob Foltz too. I've seen these names, and Gail also. I know all of your names. I just don't know anything about working with you, and that wasn't even crossing my mind as a possibility. I'm just pleased to meet you. Honored. That's it.
Well, are you ready for our questions then?
Lay them on me.
Okay. Please provide a specific example from your own experience working on a board or committee or in some other context in which you helped a group of people with diverse perspectives and opinions collectively reach agreement on a contentious issue. What did you do to influence the group, and what was the outcome?
Well, the board that I had volunteered on was with my son's school. And I was just feeling the exact same thing, compelled to be a part of the community. And the community that my son is immersed in, or was until COVID. The contention arose and were worked out. It was a really nice team to be on. And what I did was often, or what I found myself doing, since it was the first board that I'd ever been on, was adding ideas and a lot of listening and giving feedback without being, I don't know. It worked. It worked. What came up? It was in 2017, and there had been some security issues that had come up because there had been some shootings. This is when I got really concerned that it hadn't been brought up, and I said, please bring it up. I want to know more about the security of the campus, and what are we going to do? Why aren't we doing anything now? And when I feel passionate about something, I'll speak up. And I can do that with a smile and keep everybody on the subject without it being a contention. It's a concern. And water is a big concern. And how it's managed is bigger than I know. And I just expect a lot of education out of this. I've never been to a board meeting other than that. And I really enjoyed it. I learned about how board meetings run. I had never done that before. I liked being a participant. It was great.
Okay, thank you. Please describe what you think is at stake in the district's participation in the Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency.
Okay. I do not know.
Okay, fair enough. Like I said at the beginning,
I'm fully going to
answer all the questions, and that's perfectly okay. Can I go on to the next one?
Please, yes.
All right, please. Please describe your engagement with the workings of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District up until this point, besides paying your bills on time.
Right. Yeah, you know, I do. And even when they got really, really crazy high, which was when I was with the Lompico Water District, and all I knew was that there was a big, like, people connection problem. And I was removed from it because I didn't know how to become a part of it. Somebody mentioned, who mentioned that? The communication between the board and the people, the customers. Who was that? One of our, not Mark. Somebody said that. Customer
communication.
Alina, she brought that up. And it's so important. So important, because I would have jumped on this probably a lot longer ago if I didn't do so by accident this week. And I just don't know how to get involved, and I want to be involved. I am terribly concerned. We have we've been here since 2004. We've always watched out for issues in our neighborhood. We've seen leaks spring up in the streets. We know that the system is old. We know that there's an intertie. We know on the consumption side that there's a lot of things that need to happen before we can turn on our water faucet. I count every day as a blessing that we have it.
Okay. And the final question is, being a member of the board is a major commitment of time and energy. Board members can be expected to spend between 10 and 20 hours per week, sometimes more, attending board and committee meetings, reading agenda, background material, and preparing to be active participants in board deliberations. Please describe how you plan to integrate this commitment and work with any of your other obligations.
Well, my obligations just got cut in half. So I was working full time, and now I have an extra 20 hours. Also, that is not an issue for me. I have more energy than I have things to spend it on. And that was how I got involved with sending in a little bit of information about myself that I did send to you.
Okay. All right, thank you. Director Fultz, did you have a question?
No questions, thanks.
Okay. Director Henry?
Oh, of course. Jamie?
Yes. Pleased to meet you.
Yeah. You know, Lompico had a lot of problems. Problems that SLV doesn't have. SLV has different problems. But I did notice that you lived on Carroll Avenue, so I figured you lived in Lompico. So I was wondering if you knew about LADOC, which is the oversight, the Lompico Oversight Committee for the special district, for the special...
interest. Special interest?
For the special assessment.
Yes, that's what it was.
For the special assessment. And I'm wondering if you would even think about getting involved with that, because they're shorthanded. They put out recently their first annual report. Actually, I guess it's been almost a year now, and it's time for another one. And what they're looking at is, you realize that part of your tax money is paying for the assessment. For 10 years, we're going to be paying. And so they're keeping an eye on the money, how it's spent. And I don't know if you recently saw the newsletter from the district that talked about the Lompico tanks.
Yes.
Six tanks being replaced. I can't remember if it's two of them are already fully, if it's Caskey, I think it's Caskey's, and Madrone tanks are kind of in process.
Right.
And then the Lewis tanks are probably going to be the last. And if I got that wrong, Rick Rogers, just straighten me out, would you? So I would really like to see you get involved with if you don't get picked to be on the board, that you would get involved with that group.
LADOC, you called it.
Yeah, well, it's the Lompico Assessment District Oversight Committee.
Okay, I will.
Okay. I'll give them your name. How's that?
Ooh, that'd be great. That'd be fine.
Okay. Thank you.
Director To, do you have a question?
I just wanted to thank Jamie for her commitment to community service. And I would also mimic Lois in that if you don't want, if you further want to get involved in the, especially with the water area, to get involved with that LADOC thing. So that would be great if the committee.
Okay. Our last candidate or applicant is Mark Smalley. And Mark, would you spend 4 minutes or less introducing yourself?
Sure. Thanks, Gail. Thanks to the board for inviting me to participate in this process. I have 20 years of general experience as a construction project manager with extensive experience in managing utility infrastructure, which has included groundwater piping systems at various campuses and at an electrical power plant. This has given me a good background insight into the challenges that the district is facing with a lot of the water pipeline projects that the district is now implementing. In addition to that, I'm a licensed professional geologist and spent 12 years investigating soil and groundwater contamination sites. In that role, I installed numerous groundwater monitoring wells and water production wells. So I have the background and expertise on water production aspects for that avenue also. While I was working in the environmental industry, the 12 years that I mentioned, I prepared, reviewed, submitted a number of environmental impact reports, negative declarations, and similar environmental reports, not only on the environmental side, but for the construction projects that I've managed also, similar to what the district needs to do now for the various infrastructure construction that it's that you're doing. So it gives me a good insight into that. On the volunteer side, I participated with a nonprofit in San Jose called Rebuilding Together for 18 years as a volunteer, including 6 years of that time on their board of directors, serving as one of the directors. So that's my background. As a director, I think that a focus needs to be drawn on not only the infrastructure or the new projects, but also maintaining existing viable systems. If there are, and I'm not aware that there are at this point, but if there are any maintenance that's overdue, anything else like that, in order to preserve the existing infrastructure as much as possible, while also expanding into new areas. So with that, I'll leave it to you, Gail, to go through the questions.
All right. So my first question is, please provide a specific example from your own experience working with a board, a committee, or in some other context in which you helped a group of people with diverse perspectives and opinions collectively reach agreement on a contentious issue. What did you do to influence the group, and what was the outcome?
While I was on the board with the nonprofit agency, At one point, we had sufficient funds, not only to continue to operate, but to expand our services. Several of the board members were in favor of, instead of expanding services, investing in a building at that time, instead of continuing to rent. And from a capital perspective, it may have been an attractive thing for them to do, but I strongly felt that expanding our services was what needed to be done with that agency. And after several board meetings of discussion, that's what the board ended up doing. As a board, we were then able over those 6 years to expand our revenues and continue to operate successfully as a nonprofit agency.
Thank you. Please describe what you think is at stake in the district's participation in the Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency.
The long-term sustainability of the basin. The district has water production wells, along, in addition, other cities across this municipality, across the basin, have that also. We continue to need to draw on those resources, and that sustainability of the system is what needs to be focused on and what I think the district needs to focus on with that agency.
Please describe your engagement with the workings of the district up until this point in time.
I've been on the engineering committee with the water district for the past 2 years. Participating in that role has allowed me to see that the experience that I have in managing the construction of water pipeline systems, water treatment systems, and not only managing the physical in-ground aspects, but also scope, schedule, and budget. I served as the owner's representative, similar to the construction management firms that the district hires. That previous experience has allowed me to, I feel, contribute positively to the district on that engineering committee.
Thank you. And finally, being a member of the board is a major commitment of time and energy. Board members can be expected to spend between 10 and 20 hours per week, sometimes more, attending board and committee meetings, reading agenda background materials, and preparing to be active participant in board meetings. Please describe to me how you plan to integrate the commitment and work with your other obligations.
I'm recently retired and am looking for my next volunteer opportunity. Recently, I've been in touch with the Forest Service and I'm going to be doing some work with them up in the Amador County area. And I have no issues, time constraints at this point from participating with the district as a director.
Thank you. Director Henry, do you have a question that you'd like to?
Yeah. So, Mark Smolin, I unfortunately would be a third wheel, so I couldn't go to any of the engineering committee meetings. But I did see what the engineering committee sent to the board for discussion and approval. And I've always been very impressed about that. And I just wanna thank you for your 2 years of service so far. And I hope we have some more years of your time. Thank you.
I was one of several participants, Lois. I'm not gonna take credit for that.
I realize that, but I'm just, I wouldn't have known you if I saw you on the street.
You're welcome.
Director Cho.
Thank you, Mark, for applying. Very impressive resume.
I just had one question, and that you mentioned volunteering for the Forest Service. And I'm hoping that you can expand on that a little bit, because this is such a big time commitment. And how do you think you'll manage between the two volunteer opportunities?
The volunteer work at this point that they're looking to me for is to construct a bulletin board at the beginning of one of their trails that I've been frequenting for the last 25 years. And I agree that there should be a trail map and sign there. So that's so far what I've signed up for with them.
Okay, sounds manageable.
It's definitely manageable.
I lived there as a kid, so I know where it's at, so I just was curious.
I see.
Director Fultz?
No questions at this time, and I'll echo Lois, thanks for serving on the engineering committee. It's been
you're welcome.
Okay, well, thank you, all of you, for this is this has been delightful. It's actually wonderful that we've had five excellent candidates that we've get to choose from. And so what we're going to do right now is we will ask each member of the board if they'd like to make a comment before we go out to the rest of, for to the public. And so, Director To, would you like to make a comment?
Not at this time.
Okay. And Director Fultz?
Yes, I would. I would echo that in that I'm very impressed with the caliber and quality and quantity of people that applied for this open position. You know, in our valley, we have an enormous amount of talent. And a lot of times that talent could be very well used by the San Lorenzo Valley Water District in all sorts of capacities. And one of the reasons that I was so very much in favor of expanding the number of public members on committees and making sure that the committees stay as they are is to give people that have that inclination and those talents the opportunity to be able to serve the district, serve their community, and at one point in time very well perhaps become a board member and be able to bring all of that learning to that. So for those that don't get picked tonight, I would very much encourage you to continue your applications into committees and to get involved with the district. There are lots of things to do. Thank you.
Director Henry?
I think I'll wait and listen to the public.
Okay.
What they have to say.
That's fine. With that, we'll go to the public, and I will ask that you please raise your hand if you have a comment. And when you're called on, please say your name and identify the town you live in, and please keep your remarks to less than 3 minutes. So let's see, I'm trying to, do I have any raised hands out there?
Yeah.
Where am I?
Go down to participants and then up to attendees.
You have two.
So down in the middle is participants, and then after you click that, attendees is up in the corner.
Ah, thank you. All right, Kate Stolting.
Hi, am I unmuted now?
Yes, you are.
Okay, great, thank you. Thank you everyone, my name is Kate. I am a resident of Felton of almost 20 years. I've had the pleasure of knowing Jamie Eggman for more than half of that time. And I'm just here to let you know she is the real deal. You all heard her impressive background. I have found her to be extremely devoted to SLV, passionate about water usage. And I know that her big city experience for a small town water district will help us get to where we need to go. And I feel confident that she is the right candidate for this position. And I do want to thank all the other candidates also for stepping up, because it is a big time commitment. And I, as a Valley resident, I absolutely appreciate all of you, all of your willingness to do this. So thanks to everyone and the board as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Kate. Jim Mosher.
Yes, my name is Jim Mosher. I'm a Felton resident. I've been here off and on for 40 years. And I want to just echo the last person's comment and also Bob Fultz's comment of how appreciative I am of the talent we have in the Valley and the willingness of you to take this role on, which is a very challenging role. And each of you bring different talents, and I hope that we can have you stay involved with the district, whether you're chosen or not. And I just want to speak on behalf of Mark Dolson, who I've worked with over the last year, and just echo that what he said about him, about his talents in terms of building consensus and working as a team. We've been with the Friends of San Lorenzo Valley Water. He was instrumental in bringing this nonpartisan group flourishing to participate in a variety of issues around the water. I've really enjoyed working with him and been impressed with his expertise and willingness to work hard to build a team and to be successful in working across the divisions, across disagreements, to find solutions that will better the entire district as the primary goal. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. Karen Hall.
My name is Karen Hull, and I'm a resident of Felton. And I also wanted to say I was really impressed with all the candidates that applied and the incredible amount of experience that they brought. And I was sort of thinking of it from a bit more of what criteria I think are important at this very important juncture for the board when there are so many crises facing the board with financial, with debris flows, with infrastructure, and so many different things. And it seems like there's sort of three things to look at the candidates on. What relevant professional experience they would bring, particularly that complements the existing board, the experience that they have with the water district, which, as obviously the board knows, is its own beast. And even somebody myself who has environmental expertise, it's one thing to have the expertise, but it's one thing to really understand what the water board is facing and having that experience, as was said. And obviously a third criteria in working in a board with diverse opinions is having that experience, having worked with different people and being able to come to consensus. And I don't personally know any of the candidates, but I have to say that in reading the resumes and the letters and also hearing tonight, that it really felt to me like Mark Smalley brought all three of those things to the table, having spent 2 years on the engineering committee and knowing the issues, being a licensed geologist and having so much professional experience with water infrastructure, and also having served as again on the engineering committee, bringing people together, and on the big nonprofit board in San Jose. And I really think that those are the sort of looking at a distance as somebody who doesn't have a personal candidate that I was know personally that I'm lobbying for that really seem to have that set of qualifications that the board needs. Thanks.
Okay, do we have any other attendees wanting to make a comment? Richard, oh, Rick Moran. Welcome back.
Here we go.
Yeah.
Welcome. Well, my name's Rick Moran. I'm from Ben Lomond. And I had the pleasure to work with Mark for over a year on the engineering committee. And his 2 years on that committee has demonstrated to me his desire to serve this community. His input to that committee was always thoughtful and very helpful. Mark's particular interest helped refine many of the requests for proposals the committee reviewed for the infrastructure projects. Those are the things that Lois said was referring to. His commitment to this community and his experience would be a great addition to this board. Thank you.
Thank you, Rick. Any other comments? Kelly Francis.
Hi, this is Kelly Francis. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi there. I am an SLV resident for 22 years now. And after having listened to everybody, I'm actually here to support Jamie Ackerman. I've known her for over 20 years, and she is a very passionate and well-informed person. I feel she's very smart and forward-thinking and very community-driven. So I just wanted to support her and let everybody know that when the fires broke out, she was, you know, there for everybody. She wanted to know everything. She's very passionate about finding information and sharing it. So I feel that across the board, she's very balanced and wants to find solutions. And I'm extremely excited for all the candidates, but especially for Jamie.
Thank you, Kelly. If we don't have any other hands up, maybe I could go to, we do have two phone-ins or one phone-in person. Did they want to speak? I guess not, silence. Is there any other comments from the group? All right, if there aren't, then we'll go back to the board. And what I'd like to do is go ahead and get a comment from, or invite a comment from each member of the board before we consider coming to a motion. And then after we have a motion that has been seconded, there will also be another round of comments. So with that, Director Fultz, would you like to start us off?
Well, you know, after listening to everybody and the comments from everybody, I really wish we could take all five people and put them into one, because the skill sets that are there are actually skill sets that the district needs overall. And each person brings a real strength in either one or more areas. So I think what I'd like to do is hear what other board members have to say, and we'll see where we go from here.
All right, Director Henry.
Well, I do have a favorite here. Mark Smoley, everything I've heard about him and the things that Rick Moran said, he sounds like a person who will, can I say man, woman, or is that a no-no? Anyway, he seems like a person who will listen, who will work well with others, and we have so many problems in the district with our infrastructure and maintaining that infrastructure, that I just feel like he would be the best person.
Okay, Director Toh?
Hi, I'm just looking through my notes here. And this is a really tough choice. Everybody's so great. And I appreciate Alina's experience and all of her work with her research and field work. This is amazing. And Mark Dolson's experience, like working with, collaborating with other groups. Jamie Ackerman, I don't mean to get all, but I think, well, for me, the things that are important is that we recover from our fire, and our groundwater needs to be taken care of. So for me, the person that I think would serve the board best is Mark Smalley, just because he's already on the committee. He has experience with construction. He is familiar with the groundwater agency. So that is my current assessment, but I would love to hear more.
Okay. I guess I'll go ahead as the fourth person, unless Bob, unless you want to pop in now.
Oh, go ahead.
All right. Okay. I have three main criteria in evaluating the candidates. And one is whether they bring relevant skills and expertise, particularly in this time of rebuilding from the CZU fire. Whether this person has enough direct engagement with the district and general knowledge of the technical and financial issues that we're facing, that they basically can hit the ground running on joining the board, and whether they have substantive experience contributing constructively to group decision making in a relatively high stakes setting. And to me, the applicant who fulfills all three of these criteria is Mark Smalley. He brings deep expertise in utilities construction projects, including those installing water. And he served on the engineering committee for 2 years. I've also been on that committee, and what I observed is that Mark attends the meetings regularly. He's always well prepared. He's easy to work with, and he also, as we've already heard, made important contributions to the efforts of the committee, especially when it comes to sort of evaluating the contracts that we make for construction things. And these are very expensive contracts, so it's an important issue. So I think that Mark will bring an important perspective to the board that will really help us when we make decisions in the next year or so how to replace the facilities. That said, even though Mark's my first choice, I've been very impressed by the resumes of the other applicants, and I think they have a lot to offer to the board. And so as Director Fultz advised me a couple of years ago when I unsuccessfully applied for a vacant board seat, I hope you'll all think about serving on committees and deepen your knowledge of the district so that 2 years from now I might be voting for you in a board election. In fact, Mark and Elena have applied to serve on committees in 2021, and I'm going to do all I can do to make sure that they're appointed to the admin and environmental committees that they've applied to. And I think Lois had a great suggestion that Jamie, you may want to get involved with the LADOC committee. Bob?
Yeah, thanks. You know, I think the I think one of the things that I think I heard everybody say on the board is the fact that Mark Smalley is really known. That is, his work, his participation on committees, his demeanor and presence are all something that everybody knows. And I think that is one of the important criteria, in addition to the skill set that any of the applicants would bring to the board. And so I know one of the things that we talked about at a couple of board meetings ago was being able to achieve a consensus here, or at least that would be the goal. And what I'm really happy to say is I think we have done it. I think Mark Smalley is should be a great addition to our board. And I think given the challenges that we are facing here over the course of the next, several years, frankly, I think Mark is going to bring a lot of perspective to the board that we really, really need. And Mark, just so you know, there's about $10 million worth of maintenance that needs to be done in tanks that has not been done yet and is way overdue for being done. So we already have that kind of a situation. What I would say to everybody else is thank you very much for applying. And like Gail, have applied for committees, I absolutely would love to have you on those committees. And for Jamie, please do look into the LADOC committee. I think you'll get a tremendous amount of background, not only about Lompico, but also about the district in general by your participation there. And I do believe there are openings on that, or or will be if there aren't already. So thanks everybody for sharing with us all of your insights and expertise tonight. And I'm looking forward to moving this to a vote, I guess.
I think Jamie said earlier she has to leave now. So thank you, Jamie, for coming.
Thank you.
Can I just add something, James, Director of Operations? Jamie, you did say you started in Long Pico, so I just want to be sure they're all telling you to be part of the LADOC committee. Are you still in Long Pico? Because you have to be in Long Pico.
I'm here. I'm not going anywhere.
Just wanted to be sure.
James, their addresses are on the application.
I didn't look at
them. We checked that already.
Hear me there. I'll find them. Help them find me. We'll get together.
I'll thank you for joining us.
I gotta go.
There seems to be a consensus. Would anybody like to make a motion?
I would.
Okay, Lois.
I would like to make a motion that we fill the current vacancy that exists with Mark Smoley.
I'll second that.
Okay. It's been moved and seconded that we appoint Mark Smoley to the open vacant seat on the Board of Directors of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District. Is there any further discussion?
Just one question, Gail. Are we going to take it while Mark gets sworn in and all that? Are we going to take a short break?
Let's go ahead and finish the vote, and then we'll talk about that.
Okay, great.
Because we've got the motion on the table, we should act on it. Unless somebody does anybody want to have any further discussion?
Okay. No, thank you.
Okay. If not, Holly, could you take a roll call vote, please?
President Mayhood.
Aye.
Vice President Henry.
Yes.
Director Fultz.
Yes.
Director Tu.
Welcome to the board, Mark.
Thank you.
That's a yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Let me at this point just confer with Holly about how we go ahead and swear Mark in at this point. Would you like to do the honors on that?
Yes, thank you. Mark, may I ask you to raise your right hand and repeat after me. I state your name.
I, Mark Smoley.
Do solemnly swear or affirm.
Do solemnly swear or affirm.
That I will support and defend.
That I will support and defend.
The Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
Against all enemies.
Against all enemies.
Foreign and domestic.
Foreign and domestic.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance.
To the Constitution of the United States.
To the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
And the Constitution of the State of California. And I take this obligation freely.
Without any mental reservation.
Without any mental reservation.
Or purpose of evasion.
Or purpose of evasion.
And that I will well and faithfully discharge.
And that I will well and faithfully discharge.
The duties upon which.
The duties upon which.
I am about to enter.
I'm about to enter.
Welcome to the board.
Yay.
Thank you.
I would like to ask that we talk tomorrow, perhaps, and we can set up a time so that we can actually have you sign the papers.
Okay. Sounds good, Holly.
Okay.
All right. I would now like to move on to the next item of unfinished business, which is items 3B and 3C. They both involve installation of water service. And so I would like to have Rick present them together so that the board, just for sake of efficiency, and we can then, we have to vote on them as separate resolutions, but we can consider them together.
Understand, Chair. They are slightly different. The first one is a long service line agreement for Kimberly and Steve Markey, which Kimberly and Steve Markey expressed an interest in connecting to the district's water with a long service line agreement and have taken steps to acquire the appropriate easements to do so. Staff review indicates that the district has no water distribution facilities at this location and with no plans for them to build in the immediate future. We recommend that a long service line agreement be approved by the board. The second item that you spoke about has to do with three existing customers that have existing long service lines now. However, these customers have been with the district probably since the formation of the district, and their meters are a long distance from their homes. Their service lines travel along the embankment of Ziani Creek have been very problematic and have are crossing over properties without easements. District staff has worked with these three homeowners to relocate the meters to a common public bridge where they could run their service lines across the bridge. Their meters currently now are in our district, but their homes are outside the district. So we will be working on an annexation to bring their properties into the district. The resolution for those states that they are in the district, we would want to strike that. Both the agreements for all of these have been reviewed. As you recall at the last meeting, directors had some issues with some of the wording. District Council has reviewed and rewrote the agreements. They're a lot more clear, and I do believe we've addressed those issues that the board had concern on. Staff is recommending that we approve agreements for all for a long service line agreement. With that, I'll take questions, or Council Nichols would like to add on the agreements. That'd be great.
Okay, thank you, Rick. I don't have a lot to say on the agreements, except that I do think that the primary changes that were made were to clarify the language and the purpose and the ability to record the agreements against the parcel, such as by adding the certificate of acceptance. Also, the term is more clear, and what survives termination, I believe, is more clear in the agreement as redrafted. But I think it's fair to say that the spirit and the intent of the agreements really has not changed. The prohibitions that were of concern at the last board meeting related to preventing applicants under the agreements from participating in certain types of public processes, those were removed from the agreements. So, there's a lot that could be talked about here. I think what we have now is a good template that could be replicated going forward.
Okay. Director Henry, did you have anything you wanted to comment on this one?
No, I don't.
Okay. Director Smalley?
On the installation of the water service to the Markey property, does the district have any agreement on funds that they're paying for this service installation at this point?
Yes, Director Smalley, they will pay a connection fee and an installation fee to install the meter. This is a new service, and then their service line will be the responsibility, their own personal responsibility to install.
Okay.
Director Toe? Oh, I'm sorry, Director Smalley, did you have another question?
No.
Okay. Director Toe?
I didn't have a question. I just wanted to make a comment that I really hope that we can get these people their water and that we can work out an agreement tonight. Thanks.
Okay. Director Fultz?
Yeah, I have a couple of comments and some questions for Gina. I think these agreements are much, much better, and I'm prepared to move forward on them tonight. But there are a couple things that I wanted to ask about just to make sure it's clear in my mind what we're moving forward on. Gina, there is a post-termination indemnification clause, and I'm a little concerned about that relative to what that is intended to cover.
Okay. Director Fultz, it's written broadly to cover just about anything that the district may do in connection with the implementation of these agreements, which could include installation of the meter. It could include interactions around obtaining the rights of way, or confirming that the rights of way are adequate for purposes of the long service line extension. It could include potentially future activities related to, mainline extensions that are related to obligations in the agreement. So there's a lot of things that could fall within it.
Well, just to be clear on a couple of things you mentioned there. So the homeowner is expected to indemnify the district for activities that the district undertakes on their own to fulfill this, over which the homeowner has no direct involvement. Am I hearing that right?
Yes, the indemnification clause is written broadly enough to cover those kinds of activities.
Typically, indemnification isn't quite that broad. Usually it's over things that are representations that someone is making. I am uncomfortable with this being a template forever because of that. That seems overly broad. And one of the reasons I bring this up is that, these agreements aren't between the district and a customer. They're between neighbors, effectively. And the San Lorenzo Valley Water District is a small agency. And while I certainly don't want us to do anything that isn't a good business practice, I also don't want to be doing things that would be considered unneighborly. Like I say, I'm still prepared to move forward on it tonight, but I still have some ongoing concerns about that. With respect to Clause 12, which talks about the person's obligations going forward, I do want to make sure it's clear here. They are paying a fee, and they are paying a connection fee, which typically is supposed to go for the capital improvement necessary to provide water service. If we choose not to put in a main line, that is more our choice. And so depending on the circumstance going forward, and many of these will probably never get a main line, but if there is a main line that goes forward, I would certainly encourage the homeowners to keep an eye on that and make sure that they are getting themselves in the position where they're not paying twice for something. I think the impetus for this was the North Boulder Creek situation that Rick explained to me. That came about with a happy ending. No one paid twice for service. And I just want to make sure that we're that the homeowners are, negotiation can happen. I think that's what I'll say right now. But yes, let's please do move forward with these so we can get people into water. Rick, how long will it take to get the annexation going? And can we, I'm assuming we're not going to turn off service because they're not in our district right now.
No, LAFCO has provisions for emergency service and so forth. But the average that we've seen in the past for just a straight annexation has been 18 months.
Holy cow.
It's not a fast process, but they will be in water. And I will meet with the executive director of LAFCO and we'll work that out.
Okay, great. Thank you.
But we do need, and I'll refer back to Council Nichols on the Resolution 11-20-21. We do need to strike about them being in the district service area, the parcels from that resolution.
Yeah, and if I, thank you for mentioning that, could I specifically recommend specifically what I believe needs to be stricken from that resolution?
Yes, please.
Okay, so in resolution number 11, the proposed resolution, which is on page 53 of the board packet, the second whereas clause, the third line, where it says are situated within the boundaries of the district, those words should be stricken so that the proposed resolution does not state are situated within the boundaries of the district. And the third whereas clause, which states whereas comma the parcels are within the district service area semicolon and, should also be stricken from the proposed resolution.
Question, Director of Operations, James Furtado here. So if they aren't annexed in, what does that mean? I mean, I think that that should be a question, as we do serve them at this time. If they are not annexed in and we're serving them now, I mean, maybe I shouldn't ask this now, Rick, I'm sorry, but you know, just a question. Well,
in the past, we have never had one turned down, but when someone's had water, LAFCO has made every effort to move this through, and I guess we would cross that path when we come to it, but I don't anticipate that being a problem.
Yeah, that better not be.
If there are no objections, I would like to move that we adopt resolution number 10, approving the agreement regarding water service for Kimberly and Steve Markey in Boulder Creek, and also resolution 11, which is approving the agreement with Ron and Elizabeth Hyatt, Steve Hunt, and Craig Libet and Jill McClure, with the correction that we are in the second paragraph deleting are situated within the boundaries of the district and deleting the third whereas the parcels are within the district service area.
Excuse me, Gail, do we need separate votes on this? Should we ask Gina about that?
Gina?
I think that the motion is sufficiently clear to, well, okay. It as long as all the board members are prepared to vote the same way on for both resolutions, it works out fine, but it could be separated if there's any concern about, you know, directors voting different ways for each of the resolutions, because we do need to record the votes for each resolution.
Right, that's why I was asking, but okay, I'm assuming everybody's good with it.
Yeah, that was why I said without objection, I would do it this way. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Okay, any discussion? If not, Holly, would you please take a roll call vote?
President Mayhood.
Aye.
Vice President Henry.
Yes.
Director Faltz.
Yes.
Director Tu.
Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay. All right, then we go on to
Gail.
Yeah.
1 point.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Should my name have been called?
Yes, I apologize.
It's okay.
Director Smalley.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
And did we have public comment on that item?
Oh, sorry, we did not. I guess I just assumed that it was so. All right, well, it's kind of too late now, I think, so let's just go on.
Well,
do you want to go back?
That was
to invite it.
That was a good point, and I think public comment ought to be taken, and then it ought to be removed and revoted. Okay. That's what I would recommend.
All right, I will take your recommendation. Is there any public comment on these two items? How about the people on the telephone? Hearing none, then I guess the vote stands. Is that correct?
I And I apologize that I didn't catch this when we were discussing the item, but it really ought to be removed and revoted in order to make sure there's no issues.
Okay. Would you like me to restate the motion?
Yes, please. Thank you.
Motion is to adopt Resolution 10, approving the agreement regarding water service for Kimberly and Steve Markey in Boulder Creek, and Resolution number 11, approving the agreement with Ron and Elizabeth Hyatt, Steve Hunt, and Craig Libet and Jill McClure, with the following changes: the elimination of the third line in the second paragraph, which says are situated within the boundaries of the district, and the elimination of the third paragraph, which says whereas the parcels are within the district service area. That's the motion. Is there a second?
I'll second it again.
Okay. Is there any discussion among the board members? Okay. Ollie, would you like to take a roll call vote, please?
President Mayhood.
Aye.
Vice President Henry.
Yes.
Director Fultz.
Yes.
Director Smalley.
Yes.
Director Tu.
Yes.
Motion passes.
All right, good. Okay, we're all legal now, huh?
Thank you.
That with that, then we'll go on to unfinished business item D, the Redwood Park Tank Initial Study Mitigated Negative Declaration.
Yes, thank you. We have environmental planner Blanchard here tonight to present this item, which is a milestone for this project. Carly?
Great, thank you, Rick. So as Gail mentioned, we are going to discuss the initial study and mitigated negative declaration for the Redwood Park tank. Since we have some new board members, I'd like to quickly go through the project description, location, and some background information before we move on to the recommendation. So the basic goals of this project is to replace two undersized, aging, and leaking 20,000 gallon water storage tanks located in Ben Lomond near Country Club Drive and Dundee Avenue. We would then replace those two tanks with an 125,000 gallon bolted steel water storage tank on an approximately 6,500 square foot parcel located at the intersection of Country Club Drive and Dundee Avenue. The project would consist of the 125,000 gallon bolted steel water storage tank, two water pumps housed in an 80 square foot pumping station made from concrete masonry and fire resistant roofing, base rock surface or paved driveway. And then I'd like to apologize, there is a typo here. It should be ductile steel. So the 400 linear feet of 8-inch ductile steel and not HDPE or high density polyethylene water pipeline. A standby backup generator and propane tank for emergency power, an owl nesting box for rodent control, and then the revegetation of native wildlife friendly planting. For some background, the district prepared the draft initial study and mitigative negative declaration for CEQA. The original 30-day public review period commenced July 31st and was scheduled to end August 30th, but due to the CZU Lightning Complex fires in August, we extended the review period until October 2nd. After the review period, the district worked with RINCON to finalize the ISMND, respond to all public comments, create a mitigation monitoring and reporting program, and create the summary documents, facts, answers, and questions, or FAQ, summarizing responses to public comments. These are all on the district's website, and we've included a link because these documents were pretty large and they could not be included in the agenda tonight. On November 5th, on November 5th, 2020, the ISMND was taken to the Board of Directors for approval. The public voiced concerns regarding the project during public input. The board and staff decided to pull the item from questions until questions and concerns could be addressed. On December 8th, a public workshop was conducted to address questions and concerns from the neighborhood. To facilitate this meeting, the district conducted a direct mailing to approximately 260 notices to the entire neighborhood impacted by the tank and construction. The informational meeting consisted of a short presentation and a question and answer period with approximately 18 participants. Most of the questions were in regards to traffic control during the two-week construction period of the main line. There were also several questions regarding impacts to the neighborhood parking and roadways resurfacing. Staff believes neighborhood questions and concerns have now been addressed. Once the board adopts the initial study and mitigated negative declaration, or ISMND, the district will move forward with the purchase of the property. Once we have that, we will also do the notice of determination. And once that process is completed, we'll complete the sale contract. Any issues raised by the title company must be resolved prior to closing so that the district can obtain title insurance. Staff is ready to answer any questions.
There is also, too, that we have members of the public that were at that meeting. They are participants in the audience tonight. And today, district staff did install a story pole at the center of the tank location. The story pole is a pole that is erected to the height of the tank so the neighborhood could see the actual height of the tank that we're going to construct, because there was some questions with visual concerns from a neighbor directly behind the tank. I didn't talk to that neighbor this evening, and I do believe he is attending the meeting tonight also.
Thank you for that additional information. We'll go to the board for an initial set of comments. Director Smalley, do you have anything you wanted to?
I do not.
Okay. Director Toe?
Nothing at this time.
Okay. Director Fultz?
Yes, I just want to compliment and commend staff and the neighborhood for participating in this in the way that it did. I think this is really a prime example of how neighbors working together with neighbors and why this district is so important, that we're not some big faraway, company. It seemed like the issues have been worked through, but I definitely want to hear from the members of that neighborhood that are here to see if they have any remaining concerns. Carly, I did have one question on the mitigated negative declaration. Is this sort of a faster approach to obtaining environmental approval to move forward than other alternatives? And I'm not sure if the community really understood that. And I want to make sure we get that out on the table.
Right. Yeah, so the ISMND, I guess it's a little bit quicker than going through the full environmental review. And because the project had less environmental impact, we could go this route with the CEQA process.
And also less expensive, too.
Right.
Great. Thank you.
Director Henry?
Since the fire situation and realizing this new tank would give so much better fire protection for that area, because the two redwood tanks, granted we could replace them with two more redwood tanks that will leak and will not give the same amount of fire flow as the new tank will. And I think if the district fails to put in the right type tank, we would not be serving that area as it should be. And so I think, and if you haven't seen photos of the new tank, what it would look like, it really is, it looks great. It does. It's, if you haven't seen the photo of what it will look like, you ought to look at it, because it really doesn't look like the big giant probation tank, but this is a great photo of the swim tank.
I would just, before we go out to the public, I would just like to add a comment that really commending Rick and James and Carly for that meeting that they had with the public. It went on for 2 hours. They answered every question that came up. I thought it was a very productive meeting between the district and the people that live there. And mostly people that attended, they sent out invitations to about 260, but most of the people attended, I think there was 15 or 18, something like that, were the people that lived close to it. But it was quite clear to me, I think, that everybody, you know, was on board and that we were still discussing some details, and there was great willingness on both sides to cooperate. And so echoing what Bob Fultz said, I think that was something I came away with that I was very pleased at. And I think it's just a wonderful thing that those folks are finally going to get larger diameter pipes that will allow them to have adequate fire flow. And there'll be a little bit of inconvenience for a couple of weeks, but they're after CZU, we all know how important it is to have that additional protection. Can we go out to the public? Are there any comments from the public? You can raise your hand if you have a comment you want to make.
I do just want to point out Peter Parker is on the line and he had issues last time with communicating with us.
Yeah.
And he really would, I'd like to really hear from him.
So. Yeah.
Well, he's got his hand up.
He's got his hand up, so that's promising. So let's demute it or unmute him so that he can talk.
I think Peter needs to unmute himself.
Yes.
Yeah. There we go.
Here we go.
Peter?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, excellent.
Go ahead.
This is the first time I've had an unmute button. Makes it much easier. Well, I just want to, first of all, thank the directors and the board in general for being responsive to the issue of pump noise abatement. It's just been a series of good experiences. I was able to listen to a pump, and then during the last meeting, it was brought up that it's actually possible to have a pump enclosure that is soundproof as well as fireproof. And District Manager Rick Rogers proposed doing that, and I was also contacted by Director Fultz. And he seconded that, indicated that they wanted to move ahead with a soundproof version of the enclosure, not just one that's constructed of concrete block, but I assume this one is actually cast in place concrete. And they also put the story pole up. I think that was actually today that it happened, and I sent a notice out to the rest of the neighborhood if anybody wanted to take a look at that. And I was surprised that it's not quite as close to my property as I thought. But my main concern was abatement of the potential pump noise, and that issue was actually taken care of at the last meeting and confirmed by Bob Fultz. And I spoke with Rick again this evening. I'm really happy with the arrangements that the board was willing to make. I'm happy that we're going to get a big tank here. I think it's going to be a win-win solution for everyone. There were some minor points about the appearance of the tank or the fence surrounding it, but I think that's something that we can work out with Rick as we move forward on this. So I just want to really express my appreciation for the board and the way that you've handled this and the way you've included the community. And I think just speaking for myself personally, I'm really happy with the results. And I guess so we're going to be partners now that we're going to be living next door to each other. So I think we've set the tone for a good relationship. And I wish you well on the project, on your end of it.
Peter, I have a question for you, if you have a chance.
Sure.
So have you seen some of the murals that are located around Boulder Creek and other parts of the valley? I was looking at this photo and I noticed the tank itself is green. It blends in with the forest pretty well. But I was wondering if you were interested in, you were worried about the fence. And so I was thinking maybe one of the mural designers could work with the neighborhood or the district, and we could potentially paint the fence in a way that is makes it look nice, or that maybe even blends in with the surrounding forest. Is that something you think you would like?
Well, my desire is to have it disappear as much as possible. So I think, you know, painting it with a dark color that absorbs light rather than reflecting it will make it less visibly apparent. And Rick was saying that like a dark forest green is what they usually do for tanks in a forested area. I think that's a great plan. I don't think I would personally like to see it dressed up with any type of visuals that would actually attract the eye. And I have not seen the murals that you're referring to.
We just have some really talented artists in the valley, and some of the murals, like the one on the side of Johnny's Market with different things. And it doesn't have to be something like that stands out. And I get what you're saying, how you don't want it to stand out, but I'm sure those artists are talented enough to make it like the fence. You're concerned about the fence, and in the simulation, the fence is brown. And but I was thinking we could potentially do something with a low environmental impact that would make it, you know, blend in to the surrounding forest, so you potentially wouldn't notice the tank as much. That was my only thought, and I was wondering how you felt about it.
Mm-hmm. Well, if it were if it were something non-graphic that wouldn't attract the eye, I suppose that would be okay. But to me, if it's just darkly colored, that would probably do the job.
And thank you for your input.
Sure.
Do we have any other comments by members of the public? About people on the telephone? Okay. Hearing none, is there any more? Let's see. I guess we go back to the board. Director To, did you have anything to say about this? Any comment you'd like to make?
Just that the staff, I think, has done a wonderful job on this report. I was reading it over. It's very, very detailed, and I think that I want to compliment them on that. And just a side technical note, hey, Peter, if you could mute yourself, that'd be great.
Okay. I no longer have a mute. Oh, there we go.
Yeah. Director Faltz, did you want to make a comment?
No, thank you.
Okay. Director Henry?
I just want to say I'm glad we're moving ahead with this. I think it'll be good for the community.
Director Smalley?
Kudos to the district's staff on being able to effectively use the environmental review and comment process with the public that's going to be affected by this. Good job on that. This is the way it's supposed to work.
Do I have a motion? Or if
I would move to go forward with the purchase of the property and start the process of this tank.
Let me restate that. I know what your intent is, but let me just restate it, that the motion is to adopt the initial study and mitigated negative
declaration for the Redwood Park tank.
I'll second
that. I would move to adopt the initial study and mitigated negative declaration, ISMND, for the Redwood Park tank.
Okay. Second?
I seconded it.
Thank you, Director Fultz. Holly, would you do a roll call vote, please?
You're muted.
I apologize. President Mayhood?
Aye.
Vice President Henry?
Yes.
Director Fultz?
Yes.
Director Smalley?
Yes.
Director Tu?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay. We decided to remove from the agenda the next item of unfinished business, the respectful workplace policy, pending getting the background information we need. So we next have new business, and we have as A, B, and C, resolutions of appreciation for former directors. And I'm thinking that the most efficient way to do this would be to put all three of them together, if there are no objections, and voting on them as a single item. Rick, did you want
to? Yes, I'd like to request the district secretary to read the three resolutions of appreciation.
May I go ahead?
Yes, you may.
Yeah, never mind.
San Lorenzo Valley Water District Resolution Number 12-2021. Subjects, resolution of appreciation for Director Swan. Whereas on December 13, 2018, Stephen Swan was sworn in after being elected to the Board of Directors of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District, and whereas Director Swan faithfully and continuously served in his capacity as a board member for a period of 2 years, and whereas Director Swan distinguished himself as an exemplary board president in 2020 and led the district through the CZU wildfire, and whereas Director Swan was dedicated to the proper management and physical and fiscal viability of the district, as well as the protection of the district's watershed property and the environmental health of the entire San Lorenzo River watershed. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District that Stephen Swan is to be commended and thanked for his years of dedicated service, and that he has the respect of all who have worked with him, and that his efforts and dedication will be sorely missed.
Thank you.
Resolution number 13-2021. Resolution of appreciation for Director Ferris. Whereas on May 2, 2019, Louis Ferris was sworn in after being appointed to the Board of Directors of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District, and whereas Director Ferris faithfully and continuously served in his capacity as a member of the board for a period of 1 year, 7 months, and whereas Director Ferris began working with the district as a member of the Community Outreach Citizens Advisory Committee, where he was instrumental in the district earning a transparency certificate of excellence and improving outreach to the public. And whereas Director Ferris was involved in the district's engineering committee, both as a public member and as a board member. And whereas Director Ferris was dedicated to the proper management and protection of the district's watershed property and the environmental health of the entire San Lorenzo River watershed. And whereas Director Ferris was involved in the Santa Margarita Groundwater Management Agency and served as one of the district's representatives there. Whereas Director Ferris was instrumental in moving forward with the district's fire management plan. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District that Louis Ferris be commended and thanked for his years of dedicated service, and that he has the respect of all who have worked with him, and that his efforts and dedication will be sorely missed. Resolution number 14-2021, resolution of appreciation for Director Moran. Whereas on August 28, 2019, Richard Moran was sworn in as an appointed member of the Board of Directors of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District, and whereas Director Moran continuously served in his capacity on the Board of Directors for a period of 1 year and 4 months, and whereas Director Moran was dedicated to the proper management and protection of the district's watershed property and the environmental health of the entire San Lorenzo River watershed. And whereas Director Moran was involved in the district's environmental committee, both as a public member and as a board member and chair, often imparting his knowledge for the good of the district. And whereas Director Moran was instrumental in banning the use of glyphosate, a probable human carcinogen, from use on district properties. And whereas Director Moran was responsible for moving forward the adoption of the district's first integrated pest management plan, reducing the use of pesticides to the maximum degree possible. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District that Richard Moran be commended and thanked for his years of dedicated service, that he has the respect of all who have worked with him, and that his efforts and dedication will be missed.
Thank you, Molly. We go now to the board to see if there are any comments. Director Faltz?
Yes, a couple of comments, but first I wanted to suggest a couple of typos corrected.
They've already been corrected.
Well, they have?
Yes.
Oh, great.
They were sent to me earlier today and they've been corrected.
Okay, great. Because in the one I have, it's anyway. Okay, yeah. Great.
And that was the typos, Director Faltz, that you sent.
Yeah.
So if you have anything additional.
No. I because I'm looking at the old document here, it's still that way. No, so no problem. No, I wanted to really thank Rick and Lou and Steve for their service. Lou, more than anybody else, within a month or two of him being on the board, really took the entire fire preparation topic to heart and drove that through. Working with Larry Ford and others in the community to try to raise the awareness of this and work to get us prepared for a possible wildfire. And unfortunately, we saw what happened this year. But that is really, I think, going to be the foundation of all the improvements we're going to be making going forward. And certainly starting with this new Redwood Park tank, where the pump house is going to be absolutely fire resistant so that we don't get into any situations there. And with Rick, I think back to 3 years ago or so where Rick was really advocating strongly for the banning of glyphosate use within the district and really took a lot of hits initially on that. But ultimately, what Rick was advocating came out as being something that we adopted. And sometimes I think, a lot of the work that good people do, like Rick and Lou, sometimes get overlooked. And I'm really glad to see that we're putting out this resolution of appreciation. So thank you very much for bringing this to us to do.
Director Henry?
I don't have any comments.
Director Smalley? Director Smalley, do you have a comment? He's not here right now. How about Director Toe?
I just wanted to say thank you to anyone who participates in public service, and I really appreciate these three board members and all the work that they've done, especially through the CZU fire. Their preparation just really made it, I think, a big difference in how the Valley functioned during the fire. So thank you to them.
Okay, I'll return to Director Smalley. If he stepped out for a minute, then we'll just go ahead to the public. If there's any comments from the public, please go ahead and raise your hand. How about on the telephone? Okay, if not, we can come back for further comments from the board. Do you think that's necessary, or can we move to a motion? Is there anybody willing to offer a motion?
I'll make a motion to for, let's see, there's, it's 12, 13, and 14, right?
Yes.
The resolutions of appreciation for Stephen Swan, Lou Ferris, and Richard Moran. So it's motions 12, 13, and 14.
Resolutions 12. So we adopt resolutions 12, 13, and 14. Yes. Do I have a second? Tina?
I'll second it.
Okay, is seconding it? Any further discussion from the board? Hearing none, I will ask Holly to do a roll call vote.
President Mayhood?
Aye.
Vice President Henry?
Yes.
Director Falls?
Yes.
Director Smalley? You're muted. Yeah.
Yes.
Director Tu?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay, thank you, Holly. Now we move on to the next item of business, which is the board policy manual for 2021. Rick, did you want to start that off?
Yes, the recommendation is to discuss the process for making any changes to the district's board policy or to the district's board of directors policy manual, board manual for 2021. Staff proposes that each board member review the board manual and email a brief summary of any requested changes to staff by December 28, 2020. Staff would then compile all the input received from each board member into an agenda item for discussion at a regular board meeting in January. The agenda item also would include a statement of any changes recommended by staff. And with that, I'll turn it back over to Chair.
Okay. Director Henry, do you have any comments on that?
I guess I will. I think this is a good idea because I've wanted some changes in the past and nothing ever happened. So I think it's great. Everybody will be able to look at this and decide on what things they feel need to be changed, if anything. Maybe you won't, it's okay if you don't want to change anything, or if you want to change 10 things. I just think this is a really good idea.
Okay. Director Smalley?
Yes. Did I hear a time frame where you're asking for these comments back by?
Yes, asking for your initial comments back to staff by December 28th, 2020. Okay.
Thanks, I missed that.
Director Tao?
Nothing at this time.
And Director Fultz?
Yeah, I think this is a great thing. And of course, we're, you know, the board policy manual says we will review it annually. So getting into a habit of doing that, I think, is great. There are some things I think in there that do need tightening. And I have a couple other suggestions. I believe that the CSDA has some board policy templates, and I think it would be helpful for board members to be able to have access to those as part of their review. I'm not suggesting that we use the templates as is necessarily, but it certainly gives you an idea of what the CSDA is looking at as important for boards to consider. I find templates to be a little bit vanilla for, and that's because of what they're doing. It's just the nature of the beast, but it certainly is a great place to start. I believe we are members of CSDA and have access to that content. So I don't know exactly how to get access to it, whether we have a login or we can download the templates and send them to the board members, but I would very much like to review those as well. I would also like to have the board consider during the meeting where we discuss this, sending at least some of these items to the admin committee, which is the committee that we have formed and is charged with looking at these kinds of things. There may be some things that wouldn't go there just because of the nature of the item isn't conducive to having committee input. But I think by sending it to committee, we also are opening it up for more public input as well. And I think that's a good thing, particularly given who I think will be on the committees shortly, or at least who I hope will be. I obviously have some ideas myself about things that we learn and can make improvements in. And I think some of these ideas will hopefully go along with streamlining some of the aspects of housekeeping aspects of board meetings and board preparation and that sort of thing, while at the same time making sure that we retain the ability to have a very wide-ranging and free-flowing discussion about agenda items and not in any way try to inhibit or attenuate any of the conversation. Having those conversations in public is a really important thing, even if there happens to be unanimity on a particular item. So just some thoughts for us to consider as we move forward on this process.
Thank you, Director Fultz. Are there any comments from the public? Hearing none. That will just end the discussion because there's no action by the board as requested at this time. So we'll move on to item.
Excuse me, sorry. Are we going to be able to look at any of the CSDA templates? I think in order for that to happen, the board as a whole would have to give direction to staff to make those available. Is it that no one else wants to look at any of those templates? Is that what I'm hearing?
I'm interested in that, and I think that we can get the board, or not the board, the staff to do that offline potentially.
Well, you typically on special requests, you would make a the yes. board would make a request of staff to do that, and that way, yes, it will get it done. How it gets done, I don't care. I would like to very much look at those things as we're doing the review of the board policy manual.
Gina or Rick, would you like to respond to that?
The board can direct, the board chair can direct staff to facilitate that, and I've taken that as direction, and we will, we are members of CSDA. They do have templates, a different type of templates, and we will research that and get it disseminated to the board very shortly.
Great.
Thank you.
Does that satisfy you, Director Fultz?
Yeah, absolutely. Just want to make sure it's real clear. That's all.
And let's go on to our next item, which
I think Lois had a question. Sorry.
Forget it.
I already did. Go out to the public, right?
No, I was saying that Lois had her hand up, so that's why I mentioned it.
I did, but I took it down. Okay. Thank you, Gina.
The next item is agreement with Best and Krieger for legal services with a proposed loan financing.
Correct, and I will ask Council Nichols to present this item. And I would like to say before I turn it over to Gina that staff is not prepared tonight to go in and discuss the finances of the CZU fire. We are trying to just get approval to move forward entering into this contract. And very shortly, staff will be bringing information to the Budget and Finance Committee and to the full board on the finances of the district. And with that, I'd ask Gina to present.
Could I say one thing first? Could I say something?
No, I'd Lois, why don't you hold it until Gina has given her presentation?
Oh, okay. It just has to do with the resolution number. It's wrong.
Well, we can deal with that when we make a motion. Go ahead, Gina.
Okay, thank you, Chair Mayhood. So this item, the reason that I'm presenting this item is that as Mr. Rogers said, currently the posture of the item is not to finalize any of the budgetary or other sort of financial specifics related to the loan. It's to help the district to move forward with some of the actions that it needs to get the advice that it needs to hammer out the details of the loan. And once they do that, get it documented. So what's before the board tonight is that is a fee agreement with Best Best and Krieger, which is a law firm that has a public finance practice that specializes in these types of public entity tax-exempt financings. This is a type of service that Nossam and my firm has formerly provided to the district, but we are not currently well positioned to provide this particular service to the district, and therefore I am recommending that the district retain special counsel for this purpose. I can attest that, you know, I'm not familiar with a particular lawyer who will be handling the matter, but I can attest to the, you know, the firm being reputable and competent in this regard generally. So once the district, assuming the district approves or authorizes the district manager to enter into the fee agreement with Best Best and Krieger, they would be retained as bond counsel, which is sort of a generic term that gets applied to lawyers who work in the field of public finance. In this particular instance, because the district would be retaining them as bond counsel, they would be representing the district in getting a loan from a lender documented, consistent with tax laws and so forth, to ensure the district gets the benefit of tax-exempt financing, and they would provide the necessary opinions for the tax-exempt status, as well as the enforceability of the loan generally. The fee set forth in the fee agreement is $25,000 plus $1,500 in costs. That seems reasonable to me. Nossaman performed a similar service for $20,000 a couple of years ago. It certainly seems in the ballpark with what this type of service should cost. By going ahead and getting them retained, they can help advise the district in terms of how to hammer out the details of the loan. As I understand it, there's a couple of lenders in the running, and Best Best and Krieger could be very helpful in kind of narrowing that down and hammering out some of the details of what the finance package would look like and how it would be structured. So I do recommend going ahead and retaining them to help the district move forward with this process. The resolution that's in the packet is something that the proposed bond counsel asked the district to adopt as soon as possible. It's a, and it's in there, it's resolution number 16. And as Director Henry pointed out, that should be, I believe, resolution 15. Is that right, Holly? Yes.
It's quite often our practice when there's going to be a resolution that was taken off of an agenda and is going to be on another one to just change the date on it and use the same agenda. For instance, it happened after seven, and for this very same reason, it was an item that, so I don't usually go back and change the numbers. It would stay the same, and then when the respectful workplace comes up, it will remain number 15, 2021.
That seems confusing to me.
Yeah, I think we may need to talk about that I think this ought to be resolution number 15. Since 14 was the last one that was approved by the district, I think they ought to go in numerical order. So this would be number 15. The purpose of it is to take advantage of some of the laws pertaining to tax exempt status to allow the district to use the proceeds of the loan to pay, to reimburse the district for monies that it's already expended in its response to the CZU fire, in particular capital expenditures resulting from the CZU fire. So the $2 million that's in this reimbursement resolution is, as I understand it, is a rough estimate intended to be on the high side to make sure it captures everything that the district has paid within the past 60 days. The sooner this resolution gets adopted, the better, even if that $2 million number is imperfect, because if the district were, for example, to wait until January to adopt this resolution, it could lose out on the ability to refinance or to use the loan proceeds to pay for expenses in, say, early October. The entire month of October. So it's important to go ahead and get this done, and certainly there will be more to follow when and if the district goes ahead and appoints BB&K as the special counsel and adopts the resolution. And with that, I'll answer any questions.
Director Smalley, would you like to begin if you have any questions?
I don't have any questions at this point.
Thank you. Director Toe?
I also believe the finance manager is attending the meeting tonight as well. She may be able to answer questions as well.
Director Toe?
Yeah, Gina, I had a question about the fee. I did think it was a lot, but like you said, it's within range of what this sort of fee would be, and I'm unfamiliar with using this sort of service. So I'm just curious if that fee is a one-time fee. So if for some reason this particular firm has a difficult time or it takes longer than they anticipated, are they going to charge us more, or is the fee the one-time fee and until this problem is resolved?
Yeah, that's a great question. And it's intended to be a flat fee, as you see in the fee agreement. It's supposed to be a one-time fee. There's a little bit of wiggle room built into the agreement. So for example, if the district were to ask them to do things considered outside of the scope of what this would typically entail, they could tell us that they believe it's outside the scope and then, you know, start charging on an additional basis. But there would be a discussion before anything like that were to happen. We did, by the way, ask the firm about, you know, blown deal issues, and they said they've never had a blown deal problem with this type of a loan. But if that situation were to occur, that they would anticipate working out a reasonable solution. And blown deal, if you haven't encountered that before, that's where, you know, you go down the path of securing and documenting a financing, and then it doesn't close for some reason, and you've already expended quite a lot of time and energy on it. So we did have that conversation with them. I think that answer is satisfactory for this purpose, but I did want to make the board aware of that because it's not covered in the fee agreement.
Would it be okay if I asked Stephanie a question?
Go ahead.
I just wanted to ask Stephanie's opinion on this and see, you know, because I know that the staff was working towards finding this agreement on their own at first, and I'm just curious what her opinion is on this particular matter.
So bond counsel is a little different. In order for us to be able to offer lenders a tax-exempt financing, you have to have a legal opinion. And so tax-exempt financing essentially should get us anywhere from, say, 30 to maybe up to 40 basis points more favorable interest rates. So just for some perspective on that, if we were going for, say, something like a $5 million loan over 20 years, being able to get that beneficial 30 basis points should save us, you know, somewhere around, you know, close to $200,000 in the big scheme of things. So this $25,000 is going towards getting that legal tax opinion to give to the lenders that it can be tax exempt financing. And so that's kind of the big picture as to why we're going for bond council.
Thank you, Stephanie.
Director Faulks?
Yeah, thank you. If we were to borrow up to $5 million, that would end up being about 0.5%, which is not a bad VIG to pay to bond council. Gina, I'm assuming we're going to these new folks because Nossaman hasn't quite yet replaced. I think the person that was helping us last time was on her way to a different place out of Nossaman. So hopefully you guys will be able to do that so we can take advantage of all your expertise in that area in the future when we come back for the next one. I had a question either for Rick or Stephanie. What kind of expenses are we looking at covering with this? Because this looks to be more bondish than bridge loanish in terms of what we're talking about doing. And I want to make sure I understand. I know we're not going to talk too much detail about it tonight, but just give me a flavor for the kinds of things that would actually go into this.
You want to take that, Stephanie?
Sure, I can. So part of the difficulties is to get the bridge loan, you need to have the official FEMA allocation. We do not have that yet. There's about $2 million in past or upcoming expenses that are going to be coming through the door. At the end of the day, you know, the CZU fire emergencies are expected to be somewhere around $20 million. The district can reasonably assume we are going to be on the hook for approximately 25% of that. This is going to be helping to fix the immediate cash flow needs as well as go towards funding the portion that the district would be needing to pay irregardless of the portion that FEMA covers. So there will still be another round of financing for once we get the FEMA allocation, once we have an idea as to what the expenditures are going to be during that gap in period for FEMA reimbursements and what we have to pay up front.
Yeah, so at some point I do think we need to dig into this a little bit more to make sure we understand how this relates to the money that's gone out on reserves and a little bit more about what is being spent on. And of course, it depends on the term. I'm a little concerned about the possibility of getting into going into long-term debt on short-term assets or expenditures. And I know where we are right now. We don't have a lot of clarity, but at some point, we're going to need to get to that clarity. It seems like our estimates on the damage, regrettably, continue to escalate at a rapid pace. I think the last estimate we heard was somewhere between 12 and 15 million. And so we're at 20 now. What are the chances that this is going to go to 25 or 30 million, in which case the amount of money we would need to borrow would be higher, significantly higher?
I can kind of answer that. There's going to be, and as you heard tonight, there's going to be some decisions that the board is going to have to make. And our really big ticket items in the millions of dollars are the surface water supply lines.
Yep.
Now, if we go back and replace in kind above ground HDPE pipe, if that's the direction the district takes, we'll probably be okay on our estimates. But now if we go back and say that we want to bury that, we want to use a different type of pipe. For one, I'm not even sure it can be done with the environmental constraints, but it'll be considerably a lot more expensive. So we're pretty confident that these prices that we have now, we've had a really well investigation of our facilities. We feel that we have a good list that we should not, you know, the latest we found was we had two tanks that were contaminated. Coatings that were possibly had to be recoated, would put close to an extra $1 million onto it.
We're still sampling those and we'll find out where we're at on those shortly. We feel that we have all the damage captured, but now it's gonna say how we replace things. You know, we lost several above ground lines, even in the distribution system to bury. FEMA will cover some of that, but when we change the type of construction, we relocate to a different location, you know, instead of going cross country, we go into the roadways, there's going to be more expenses. And we'll just have to take those project by project.
Rick, thanks. Do we have a sense of what FEMA will do relative to replacing, perhaps according to current best practices, as opposed to replace like for like? So for example, if we were to replace like for like, they'd do 75% of that. But if we were to do something to reflect current best practice, better fire hardening and the like, are they basically going to say, hey, anything over 75% of like for like, you're on your own?
Well, there's a potential for that. But in the past, and I can only go on past experience, because in the past where we've had standards, where we adopted standards, you know, AWWA standards, waterworks standards for engineering, they have paid for increasing sizes. We have taken 2-inch mains and replaced them to 6-inch main because that's our current standard. And we practice that ourselves. So there is a good potential to receive funds. Now, it's when it gets a little tricky is when you change locations. Now, possibly when we change from going cross country, which may be 3 times longer than going cross country, but because the district doesn't have a standard at this time to say no more, you know, cross country above ground.
Right.
So there's going to be, and that'll be determined when we have the actual inspections. And we had a 2-hour meeting again today with FEMA. We're having a lot of meetings with FEMA, and we're getting ready that it sounds like they're going to send a team out. We're still entering documentation, damage surveys and so forth in the FEMA portal. They have a huge new website that all this is going into, and it seems to be time consuming even for the FEMA folks to enter. But we'll know more, you know, each week we know more.
And these estimates then are more or less based on replacing like for like, the 20 million is?
No. It's actually relocating. It's what I would, well, we believe the estimates to be to replace it to today's waterworks standards, you know, AWWA standards, district standards in public right-of-ways. I have a strong opinion that we should no longer go cross country and above ground.
On the surface water collection pipe, you're saying?
On our distribution system as well. We've also had a lot of piping, all the piping between our reservoirs at Lyon, between Lyon, Little Lyon, and Big Steel were above ground. They went cross country. Now the replacement we just put in were buried and a reductile iron. We made a complete switch over.
Into rights of way.
Well, there is no right of way at Lion Tank. I mean, they're so close, there are no roadways.
Right.
But we're assuming that we're going to move ahead with putting in the right of way under pavement and buried.
Sorry, my question was specifically about the raw water collection.
For raw water is to be determined. We will be doing an engineer study to see what is constructible, the different types of construction, environmental concerns and costs. And that will be brought back to most likely first off to the engineering committee to discuss before we do the RFP. And then that information will be brought back to the engineering committee and then forwarded to the full board.
So if we were to do something like bury ductile pipe, do we think that that would go be above 20 million?
Not, it would move our total, yes. I believe it would be.
Okay.
So hang
on 1 sec. So I just want to make sure one more comment that it's very possible that this number could go up based on what we decide to do and based on the engineering estimates on that raw waters collection, the raw water collection options.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we're getting a little far away from the item at hand here, which is trying to get this legal work underway.
We are putting a number on the table here now, Dale.
Director
so
Fultz,
it's not completely far
Director
away.
Fultz, you are not recognized right now. Director Henry is recognized. Director Henry, do you have a comment?
Yes. I think that we need to move ahead with this. We may not have exactly the correct numbers that we need, but we need to move ahead so we can start doing work. We're gonna run out of money if we don't move ahead. That's all.
Okay, thank you. I would like now to go to the public. Are there any comments on this from the public? How about somebody on the phone line? Okay. If not, we'll go back to the board. Is there anybody that would like to make a motion?
I'll make a motion that we approve the agreement with Best and Krieger.
Okay. Can I just restate that slightly?
Sure.
That we adopt resolution number 15, we've changed the number to 15, that authorizes the district manager to execute the letter of agreement on behalf of the district and engage the law firm of Best and Krieger as special counsel for the purposes set forth in the agreement.
And Chair Mahood, if I may, the item contains a couple of matters that are loosely related. Do you mind if I propose a slight restatement?
Yes, please, go ahead.
If I may, I'd recommend that the motion be to adopt the proposed resolution, now number 15, and to authorize and direct the district manager to enter into the fee agreement with Best and Krieger.
I thought that's just what I read. No? Okay, if that's not what I said, go ahead. State it as Gina said it. And is there a second?
Second it.
Thank you. Holly, would you go ahead and do a roll call vote?
Excuse me, I have one additional question.
Okay, go ahead.
That is Jermaine. And the reason I was asking for these questions is right now the resolution says that this will, that the reasonably expected maximum principal not to exceed $5 million. Gina, what happens if are we locked into this at this point, or can this be modified in the future?
Well, and unfortunately the person who would be best qualified to answer that question would be the BBK bond attorney, but after reading the regulation that this resolution is trying to take advantage of, I think the more important number is the $2 million, and the $5 million is a little more flexible. So I think if the ultimate borrowing went a little over the $5 million, that wouldn't necessarily defeat the purpose of this resolution.
Even if that maximum amount went up as much as to, let's say, 8 or 10 million.
I can't say that with certainty, but I do think there's some flexibility in there. Okay. I certainly would want to avoid a situation where we have to rescind and readopt this later, because we could lose valuable time in terms of having, being able to reach back as far as we can for reimbursable expenses. So, I think that $5 million number is supposed to be a reasonable estimate, but there is some flexibility. I'm just not able to say, whether it can capture any particular number higher than $5 million.
I understand. So it might be that we do another resolution that would increase that particular amount while still allowing us to retain the $2 million that we more desperately need to make sure we're covering.
I think an approach like that most likely would do the trick.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Are there any other comments or questions following the motion? If not, would Holly please read the roll call vote, please?
President Mayhood?
Aye.
Vice President Henry?
Yes.
Director Faulds?
Yes.
Director Smalley?
Yes.
Director Tu?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay, that brings us to our final item, the Local Agency Formation Commission solicitation of nominations. Rick, did you want to?
Basically, the purpose of this item is to solicit nominations for the regular and alternative member seats on the LAFCO agency, the Local Agency Formation Commission, LAFCO. The independent special districts in Santa Cruz County get three positions on the LAFCO board. The regular member seats are currently held by Jim Anderson, who's a Felton Fire Protection District, with a term ending in May 2021. And Rachel Lather, Soquel Creek Water District, with a term ending in May 2023. The alternate member seat is currently held by Ed Banks, who is the Pajaro Valley Public Cemetery District Director, and his term is ending in May 2021. As a result, the two seats will become vacant in May 2021, and one regular alternative will be available. The one interesting thing is that the term of the office will begin in May 2021 and will end on May 5th, 2025, pursuant to the Commission's Independent Special District Selection Committee policy, which is available on the LAFCO website, indicates that the two regular members cannot be from the same type of district, fire, water, recreation, or miscellaneous. Since the regular member currently is in the middle of a term from a water district, the regular position being filed cannot be from a water district. Okay. I'll turn that back over, but the alternate I do believe could be from the water district.
It strikes me that this is largely an informational item.
It is, and if someone wanted to be interested or you wanted somebody from another agency, you could nominate that person or call that person, or if you wanted to throw your name in the hat for the alternate.
Okay.
It is largely informational.
Yeah. Is there any discussion among the directors or questions on this?
I just wanted to say that I did look at the LAFCO website, and the information, if you are interested, is on their, I think, the front page. So.
Okay. Any other comments by the directors? How about the public? Hearing none, I think that brings us to the end of our agenda. We didn't quite make Tina and my goal of 2.5 hours, but at least we are just under three. So if without objection, I will declare the meeting adjourned at 8:57. Okay.
Mark, welcome to the board.
Great having you. Mark.
Welcome, board. Welcome.
All right.
Thank you.
Good night, all.
Okay, good night.